Right now we're experiencing things like hurricanes and flooding and heat waves in sort of degrees and intensity we've never seen before. So we need to understand where these events are happening in relationship to people and critical infrastructure, drink clean water, drinking sources, electricity, and that kind of thing.
The most important element of disaster response after these extreme events is really human life. And certainly power, water, transportation are all critical pieces of that.
There are many different aspects of extreme events. To understand like extreme events generation and down to the impacts of extreme events, it requires very integrated modeling approaches.
Well, we focus on extreme events that are varied from hurricanes, which have a favorable timeline. You know when they're developing, you kind of understand when they're going to hit and where there's some changes there. But to earthquakes, you know, what damage has been done in earthquakes, those are not predictable in the same way. Most recently, I'm focused on wildfire, which is also a little bit of a challenge in terms of there's somewhere in between hurricanes and earthquakes, right? We have an idea where wildfires might be most likely, but where they're going to start and how big they're going to be is relatively unpredictable.
Extreme events in the context of climate science and hydrological science, they are rare events and deviates from the typical or average condition, you know, kind of experience. For instance, like, you know, major flooding caused by heavy rainfall or like prolonged droughts, you know, leading to water scarcity. So those kind of, you know, very extreme conditions which creates impacts to a lot of things, for instance, humans, communities, infrastructure, and economics.
The process of data collection, data curation, and data assessment, that is a very large portion of the work itself.
When we're looking at, for instance, wildfire, you can look at an image from space and see where it is. Matter of fact, you can see smoke quite easily in the visible bands. Some of the bands actually see through the smoke, and some of the sensors that we use can see through clouds. And so it's easy to kind of picture it as a picture from space, but there's more to it on the physics side. We understand those physics also as geospatial analysts. We understand other information: where are the roads, where are the rivers, where are the other things going on. And we have models, or basically algorithmic approaches, that say when we have data from this sensor, this is the algorithm we run it through.
PNNL, of course, works on many different fronts. We bring in experts from many different domains. So we're bringing together experts in machine learning and AI. We're bringing together experts in climatology. We're bringing together experts in electrical grid. And then what I do is the geospatial side of it.
We have to work with a diverse range of experts in the field. We work with climate scientists for understanding how those extreme events were formed, you know, through those, you know, climate dynamics. And then, you know, I'm a hydrologist, so I'm taking the climate information to generate those responses, you know, from the land and river systems. And for understanding impacts, we work with like social scientists, data scientists, and also economists, you know, to understand how those extreme hydrological events will be creating impacts for different, you know, sectors, for different, you know, kind of communities. So it's, you know, it's a complex story.
I think the most exciting part of this is that we are applying our science, bringing our science to a problem that has national significance. And also, we are providing information that can have a big difference on the ground during and after.
We have the technology, we have the creativity, we have the compassion, and we have the people to do the kind of work that's going to be required.